morning. Welcome to our service this morning. It's lovely that you can join us, and we hope that as we meet together, even though we're online and virtual, we'll still be able to grow to know and love Jesus more together. Don't know about you, but I found the last few weeks as we looked at the Ten Commandments, things that you kind of think you know really well, really very challenging for me personally, and I'm sure we'll find that again as we look at the next of the Ten Commandments today. Now, as we begin, loads of things that I need to remind you of and let you know about, things coming up. Don't forget both the DEF Lent Bible School on sexuality and human flourishing, happens each Wednesday. Details for that on the St. Bob's blog. Our Discipleship Explored course on Sunday evenings at 6:30 over Zoom. If you haven't joined us yet for that, please do consider doing that. It's been really good, and I know that the people who've come along have found it really very helpful and encouraging. And also the interview that we saw a clip of last week with Andrea Williams from Christian Concern. If you haven't had a chance to watch that, then that is available on our YouTube channel and is very well worth half an hour of your time. All of the bits and pieces of information are in Church Family News, which you can find a link to on our website. We have it published on our website. However, if you'd like it emailed to you, Jim Routon, who's putting it all together for us, has said if you email him, he's very happy to email it to you each week, if that would be easier for you. The final thing I need to let you know about is next week, if you didn't know this already, and to be honest, when I mentioned it to Lincoln 180, most of them hadn't a clue. Next week is Mothering Sunday, okay? So just giving you a heads up there. Anyway, we're going to have a special Mothering Sunday service online next week. So if you've got young children who wouldn't normally watch our online service, do maybe consider watching with your family next week. Hopefully there'll be lots of stuff there for the children. But also, as we do and have done in previous years, we want to give flowers out to mums and actually all ladies in our congregation. And so after the service, from about 11 o'clock next week, there'll be the opportunity, if you want to, on your daily exercise, to walk via Church House, pick up some flowers to take for your mum, or maybe for a lady in the congregation who you know would really appreciate it. So that'll be from 11 o'clock next week. Just giving you a heads up, and we'll give you more details about that during the Mother's Day service next week. Well, let's just take a moment to pause, to think about why we meet, to think about why we take the time out to come to church, even if it isn't physically. The start of Psalm 116, which we looked at last week, says this: I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my pleas for mercy, because he inclined his ear to me. Therefore, I will call on him as long as I live. And so, loving Heavenly Father, we call out to you this morning that you would hear our cries, that you would hear our prayers, that you would speak to us through your word. Lord, that you would draw us closer to you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And so we sing our first song, which just has wonderful words. Whatever we're going through, when we know Jesus, we can say, it is well with my soul.
Sorrows I see, billows roll. love will last forever. It's like a mighty river that flows and flows forever, never stopping.
Oh, what a lovely song, Jasmine. Ooh, that's a really nice song, isn't it? Jasmine, are you okay?
What is that?
This is my new pet, Clive. He's a crow. I got him during lockdown. Do you like him?
He's a little bit starey.
Oh, I love him. He's very gentle.
Is he?
Yes, do you want to stroke him?
No, thank you.
Okay, how about you both talk to each other? Clive, this is Jasmine. Jasmine, this is Clive.
Hi, Clive.
Oh, I think he's a bit shy.
I think you should take him back to the shop. He's weird.
Oh, Jasmine, how can you say that? Look, you've hurt his feelings now. And I'm not taking him back to the shop. When I bought him, I decided that I would love him forever. That means until
he dies.
Jasmine? Oh, yes. But I just didn't want to say that in front of him.
That's a long time to love him, isn't it? What if he nips you, or gets poorly, or he's just a lot of work, or you get bored of each other? You might regret deciding that. Forever is a long time.
Ooh, Clive says that he really enjoyed your song at the beginning.
Oh, thank you.
Ooh, he says, can you sing the song again? He wants to hear the words.
Your love will last forever. It's like a mighty river that flows and flows forever, never.
Ah, beautiful, Jasmine. What lovely singing. Clive wants to know what you were singing about. Whose love lasts forever?
God's love. His love lasts forever and ever and ever and ever and a very long time. It never stops.
Clive says, who does God love forever?
His people. Anyone who puts their trust in him. He says he loves you and me that long too.
He says, is a long time a whole year?
Longer.
10 years?
Even longer.
Well, how long, Clive says. He doesn't really get it. Clive, forever means that God loves his people and his love never ends. It's a little bit like this. An ice cream ends when you've had the last mouthful, doesn't it?
Or when a seagull steals it.
Oh yes, that's horrible. I'm sorry. Has that happened to you as well? Oh, that is horrible. Or how about when your favourite film finally comes to an end, when everything's been sorted and everyone's happy again?
I'm usually quite pleased by that time because a film is a long time to sit still for.
Another example of when things end is when you eventually get old enough to go to secondary school and you leave your primary school. And you'll be doing that soon, Jasmine.
I am so not big enough yet.
Yes, I know. But all of these are examples of when things eventually come to an end, don't they?
Yes.
But God's love has no end.
Whoa! Kirsty, I know something else like that. My mum and dad have told me about it.
What is it?
When you get married.
Oh, well done, Jasmine.
I think I quite like you after all, Clive.
So what do you mean about getting married?
Well, my mum and dad say that God created the idea of marriage. He decided that a man and a woman leave their parents and then be with each other and love each other, together, forever.
You're right.
And a bit like Clive, they promise that even if they sometimes annoy each other, or sometimes get bored of each other, or even if they get ill, or have no money, that they'll stay together forever and love each other, always.
Jasmine, you are totally right. Well done. And you know what's even more amazing about marriage? The Bible says that marriage is like a special picture or an idea to help us to understand God's love, his forever love with his people.
So even if I muck up or am annoying or make God sad or get really poorly or I'm not very nice, God will always love me forever.
Yep.
Whoa, I think you're right, Kirsty. I quite like Clive. He's cute. Even if he does nip or gets poorly, or is a lot of work, or you get bored of him, I reckon you're right. I think you should keep him forever, just like God promises to love us forever.
A mighty river that flows and flows forever and ever.
Well, it was great to meet Clive the Crow, and also great to be reminded of God's everlasting love. That everlasting love which he shows us no matter what we've done, no matter how we fail, because of his wonderful grace that is shown towards us through his son, the Lord Jesus. We were thinking a bit about that at Lincoln 180 this week. Now, yes, God does show us his grace. And God's grace is undeserving. However, we still, the Bible says, need to come before him and admit our need for his grace because of our sin and because of our rebellion. So let's do that together, shall we? So let's pray. For turning away from you and ignoring your will for our lives, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For behaving just as we wish, without thinking of you, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For failing you by what we do and think and say, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For letting ourselves be drawn away from you by temptations in the world about us, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For living as if we are ashamed to belong to your Son, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. And we were reminded last week in Psalm 116, verse 5, gracious is the Lord and righteous, our God is merciful. Lord, we thank you that you do show mercy to us who are sinful. You show mercy to us through your Son. We thank you and praise you that that means that we can know your freedom and your forgiveness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now let's pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And let's continue in our prayers.
I'll start this morning's prayers with words from John chapter 8, verse 12. So let's pray. I am the light of the world, says the Lord. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Lord of all life, you created the universe where all things reflect your glory. You give us this great and beautiful earth to discover and to cherish. Holy God, you made us all, each wonderfully different, to join with the angels and sing your praise. Lord God, you give us your word with ears to listen and hearts to respond. Lord God, your word is our path and your truth is our light this day and every day. Holy God, you walk alongside us and speak to us throughout the scriptures, in the message of the prophets, in the songs of David, and in the vision of Paul. Your Son Jesus Christ listens to our hopes and fears and shows us how to live. In our love of neighbour, our desire for justice, and in our dying and rising each day. We give you thanks for the gift of the Spirit, which comes like the wind and moves through our lives. Lord, we ask that we might know what it means to be born of the Spirit and to know the love you have for us and the world. Lord, your word is our path and your truth is our light, this day and every day. We thank you, Holy Father, because when we turned away, you sent your beloved Son Jesus, who gave his life for us on the cross and who shows us the way to eternal life. We pray, Lord, that you deliver each one of us from worldly possessions and passions. Lord, your word is our path and your truth is our light this day and every day. Lord, we pray for your word and the world leaders. We pray that your spirit will continue to move like the wildfire in China and other countries and engulf them in the flames of your gracious love, proclaiming the message of the gospel. We pray for the world leaders that they may be humbled before you and remember that all they have and possess comes only through your grace. Lord, we also pray for persecuted Christians across the world. We pray that they will continue to stand firm on the rock of love of you and continue to serve you in faithfulness and holiness. Holy God, we pray for our own country and thank you for the vaccination program that is going so well. We thank you for the ability that you have given our scientists to protect us from coronavirus. Lord God, we pray for your love, mercy and healing for some members of our church family in need, those who are sick and housebound, and those who are suffering in any way. We also pray for those who have died recently and those who died at this time of year. Lord, we give you thanks for their lives. Lord, your word is our path and your truth is our light this day and every day. Finally, some words from Psalm 43. Lord God, send out your light and truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. Amen.
The power of his promise. mountain shall be moved, and the power of the gospel shall prevail. For we know in Christ all things are possible for all.
Today we have two readings. The first one is from Deuteronomy 5, verse 18. And you shall not commit adultery. Our second reading is Psalm 106, verse 1 to 14, and 47 to 48. Praise the Lord. I give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. For his steadfast love endures forever. Who can utter the mighty deeds of the Lord, or declare all his praise? Blessed are they who observe justice, who do righteousness at all times. Remember me, O Lord, when you show favour to your people. Help me when you save them, that I may look upon the prosperity of your chosen ones, that I may rejoice in the gladness of your nation, that I may glory with your inheritance. Both we and our fathers have sinned. We have committed iniquity. We have done wickedness. Our fathers, when they were in Egypt, did not consider your wondrous works. They did not remember the abundance of your steadfast love, but rebelled by the sea, at the Red Sea. Yet he saved them from his name's sake, that he might make known his mighty power. He rebuked the Red Sea, and it became dry, and he led them through the deep as through a desert. So he saved them from the hand of the foe, and redeemed them from the power of the enemy. And the waters covered their adversaries. Not one of them was left. Then they believed his words. They sang his praise, but they soon forgot his works. They did not wait for his counsel, but they had a wanton craving in the wilderness, and put God to the test in the desert. Verse 47. Save us, O Lord our God, and gather us from among the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name, and glory in your praise. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. And let all the people say, Amen. Praise the Lord.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to be here again today, isn't it? I'm aware that last week there were some very difficult ideas and concepts that we were thinking about. And I know that some of you have been mulling them over during the week. If that's you and you want to ask me any questions about last week, then please do send me an email or contact me. I'd be glad to think things through with you. Now, I have to say that today's subject is no less controversial, I'm afraid. We're considering the commandment, do not commit adultery. Again, as last week, on the face of it, that sounds fairly straightforward. But as we begin to dig, I think you will find that there's much more to it than at first appears. Before we do that, though, let's bow our heads to pray. God our Father, we thank you again now for your word, for its truth and its power. We pray that you be at work by your Spirit this morning, so that we can understand and apply what you have to say to us today. In your name we pray. Amen. Now, I've been doing a little bit of research. It's amazing what you can find out on the internet. I've been looking at some of the government statistics, and they make very sobering reading. Did you know that in 2019, the most recent year for which there are reliable statistics available, there were 108,000 divorces in the UK. 108,000. When you look at that statistic, it sounds high because it is. But you notice as you look back over previous years, the number of divorces is actually falling. Well, that's a surprise, isn't it? Until you realise that the number of marriages is also in free fall. One comment on one of the government documents says this: marriage rates are now at the lowest level on record. This continues a gradual long-term decline seen since the early 1970s, with numbers falling by a third over the past 40 years. That's numbers of marriages, people that choose to get married. They've been falling since the 1970s when the decline started. It's very interesting to note here that there is a correlation between falling marriages and falling church attendance. We need to be a little bit careful, as any statistician would tell us. A correlation doesn't mean a cause, but it's very interesting, isn't it, nonetheless? What about families in Britain today? Well, this came as a surprise to me, but 48%, that's nearly half, of all births today are born to parents who are not married to each other. That's nearly half the babies born have unmarried parents. Just to put that into some kind of context, in 1970, it was 8%. In 1900, it was 4%. So you see, a slight increase from 1900 to 1970 over those 70 years, just a small increase in children born to unmarried parents. But since 1970, in the past 40 or so years, a massive increase to 48%. And when it comes to family life, do you know there are 2.4 million separated families in Britain today? 2.5 million. Now, thinking about divorce and family life and childbirth does lead us on to think about the obvious next subject, which is that of sex. I don't know whether these statistics will surprise you, and if you don't want to know, cover your ears, but these are quite shocking. Of women who get married today in the UK, 95% of them are not virgins. 95%. Now, that may not be a surprise to you, but this may be. The average age for a child's first sexual experience in the UK average age is 16. Now, that's the legal minimum age, but that's the average, which means there must be a considerable number younger than that. And indeed, the statistics bear that out. 30%, one in three, a third of our children are having sexual relationships before the age of 16. Over a lifetime, the average number of sexual partners for a man is 13 today, and for a woman, it's 7. And if you say to most people today that sexual activity is to be reserved for marriage, that you ought to be married before you sleep with somebody, you'll get the most quizzical looks. What? Are you off the ark? Don't be ridiculous. How mad is that? People just won't understand. They just won't get it. And there are knock-on effects. For example, in the housing in this country, we're told there's a housing crisis. But do you know that more and more housing developments have to have more and more small houses for single occupants? Because people who get divorced stay single and live in their own houses. It's a tragedy. But you say to me, Mark, get real. This is the 21st century. We need just to live with it. We need to say this is the way it is and just go with it. Why should we be bothered? Why should it bother us? Why ought we to have any concern at all? Well, quite simply, we should be bothered because God is bothered. God made us. He made us the way we are, and he knows the best way for us to live. So let's think a little bit about what God says about marriage. Now, this is not a sermon on marriage, but we need to just cover the ground a little bit to set the scene. We need to understand what God says. And in doing that, we need to say, first of all, that marriage is not simply a human convention. It's not something that we can replace with something else because we didn't invent it. God made marriage. Way back at the beginning of the Bible, we read about marriage. If you have a Bible there, turn with me, will you, to the very beginning, Genesis chapter 2. And I'm going to read from verse 23. But let me set the scene. God has made Adam. He's put him in the garden. He's told him to rule creation, to look after it, to care for it. And then God says, Adam, you're all on your own. You need help. So all of God's creation passes before Adam, and nobody is found that's a suitable helper for him. So God puts Adam to sleep, takes one of his ribs, and creates a woman. And when Adam sees the woman, he says this: "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. The man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed." It's a wonderful picture, isn't it? The sheer joy in Adam when he finally meets the woman, his companion. And they join together in marriage. Jesus himself refers to this, so we know this is talking about marriage. And the marriage bond is shown here to be one that is absolutely strong fulfillment of what Adam and Eve both want. It is deeply stable. They are stuck together as one person. There is comfort in that relationship. And there is safety in that relationship. That's what marriage is meant to be in God's plan. And right at the heart of marriage is the idea of love. And let me tell you, right up front here now, I'm not going to go into it in any detail, but the Bible is not squeamish at all about erotic love. It's one of the main types of love in the Bible, and it's the love between a husband and a wife. As you read through the Bible, there's a whole book devoted to it. It's called the Song of Songs or the Song of Solomon, a celebration of the joy of married love. So when we read the Bible and we read about marriage, how God made it, we see three things. First of all, we see that marriage reflects the nature of God. We don't have time to go into that in any detail now, but take it from me. The biblical picture is that marriage reflects the nature of God. Marriage, second, reflects God's love for his people, for his covenant people. And the third thing we find is that marriage love, reflects the love that Jesus has for the church. The church in the book of Revelation is called the bride of Christ. It's a marriage analogy deliberately. And so, the commandment that we have before us this morning says, do not commit adultery. That means three things within this word. The first is any type of immorality. The second is what we would call adultery, or what the world would call cheating on your husband or wife. The third is an old Bible word which gets a bad press today, and the word is fornication. What that means is any sexual activity outside of marriage. So those three things are encompassed in this commandment. Immorality, adultery, and fornication. Why is this commandment here? Why is it so bad to be immoral? Why is adultery such a difficult thing? Well, the answer is that God is our great covenant God. And God's covenant relationship with his people is depicted as a marriage. It's described as a marriage. Flick with me to a few passages in the Bible, if you've got one to hand. Isaiah chapter 54 and verse 5. Here God is talking through Isaiah to his people. And he says this, Isaiah 54, verse 5. For your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name. And the Holy One of Israel is your redeemer. Do you see, the redeemer, the one who saves his people, is the one who is holy. And he is called the husband of his people. Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 20. Jeremiah 3, 20 says this. Surely as a treacherous wife leaves her husband, so have you been treacherous to me, O house of Israel. So the disobedience of God's people, the way they have treated God's covenant law, is likened here to an unfaithful, immoral, adulterous wife. See, marriage and adultery are used very closely to describe the relationship between God and his people. Jeremiah chapter 31 and verse 31, that wonderful chapter about the new covenant that's coming. Jeremiah writes this: "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord." See, God's covenant people are seen in the prophets as an adulterous people. They've turned their backs on God and they've gone after other gods. But God does not forget them. In Isaiah chapter 62, we read this. 62 verse 4. "You shall no more be termed forsaken, and your land shall no more be termed desolate, but you shall be called My delight is in her, and your land married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married." Now, in the old version of the Bible, the King James Bible, the word that's married in the English Standard Version here is the word Beulah, that some of you will know and remember. Your land will be called Beulah, which means married, because the Lord delights in you. In Hosea chapter 2 and verse 16, the whole book of Hosea is around a picture or the act of an adulterous woman relating to God's people and their relationship to God. Hosea 2:16 says this: "And in that day, declares the Lord, you will call me my husband." And then in Malachi, the very last book in the Old Testament, "The man who does not love his wife, but divorces her, says the Lord, the God of Israel, covers his garment with violence, says the Lord of hosts. So, guard yourselves in your spirit and do not be faithless." Guard yourselves, says God. Just a few extracts from across the Bible that show us how God and his people in his covenant love are seen as married. So the Bible says, be faithful, obey God, obey him, however hard it may seem, because that is the right thing to do, because God made you and God knows you better than you do. Be faithful, obey God. But you may come back and say to me, "But Mark, it's all just too hard." In the culture in which we live today, how can we be expected to live so differently from everybody else? The peer pressure is just so great. Let me remind you that the peer pressure in the first century for the church was every bit as great as it is today for us. Immorality was just as widespread then as it is now. And in fact, pederasty was a common practice that was legal in the first century. It's always been hard for Christians. We've always been different from those around us. Be faithful. Obey God. But you say, "I've got teenagers, teenage children. How can I teach them? How can I prevent them from living like the rest of the world? Well, of course, there's no easy answer to that, except to say, pray for them. Get other people to pray for them. Pray that they would remain faithful and obedient to God. But it's just so hard, you say to me. Look at the media that we're faced with. If I asked you to count how many times every day on the TV that we watch this commandment is broken, I think you'd be surprised how frequently it is. Bearing in mind that includes immorality, adultery, and fornication. The media just seems to have break this command at every turn. And then what about the music we listen to? Particularly the music our children listen to. I don't know whether you have ever listened to some of the words that some of our children are listening to. Have a listen. If you're not a teenager, have a listen. I think you will be shocked at the explicit lyrics that there are in music that's aimed at teenagers. It may be hard, but God says be faithful. God says obey me. Now, where does Psalm 106 fit into all of this? You may very well ask, and that is a very good question. But do you remember last week I said that the book of Psalms is the hymn book of God's covenant people, and it reflects the heart of God's covenant people. Psalm 106, if you read the whole thing, is a psalm about God's covenant people, how they've turned away from God, despite his covenant love. Let me just read a few verses for you. Verse 35, we read this. They mixed with the nations and learned to do as they did. They served their idols, which became a snare to them. They sacrificed their sons and their daughters to the demons. They poured out innocent blood, the blood of their sons and daughters, whom they sacrificed to the idols of Canaan, and the land was polluted with blood. Thus they became unclean by their acts and played the whore in their deeds. It's a very sorry picture of a nation, a people who turned their backs on God and followed the nations around because they thought the nations around had better things to offer. They deserted their covenant God like an adulterous wife. What should God do? Should he cast them away? What should he do? Look down to verse 44. Nevertheless, God looked upon their distress when he heard their cry. For their sake, he remembered his covenant and relented according to the abundance of his steadfast love. He caused them to be pitied by all those who held them captive. Isn't that a fantastic promise? Even though his people were departing from him and doing abominable things, we read here, God remembered his covenant. God went on loving his people. Later on in the Old Testament, the book of Hosea, as we've already heard, is based on an adulterous relationship. And it's one of those books of prophecy that's God telling his people off for being disobedient and for being faithless. But at the end, or near the end of that prophecy, comes one of the most beautiful chapters in the whole of the Old Testament. I've preached on it many times. It's Hosea chapter 11. I'm not going to read the whole chapter, but let me just read to you what God says to a faithless generation. He says this: My people are bent on turning away from me. and though they call out to the Most High, he shall not raise them up at all. How can I give you up, O Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboim? My heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender. Isn't that a wonderful picture of a God of love? A God who is full of covenant love for his people. And it's because God loves us like that, that we want to obey him. We are his. Let's live like it. So just to sum things up and round this off. Marriage is a deeply profound union. Deeply profound. It's not merely a convention. It's a union that is despised, misunderstood, and corrupted by our world. But it's a union in which we need to have ongoing faith. May our marriages, those of us who are married, may our marriages be what God intends. For those of you who are not married, but one day will be, seek the right partner. Keep yourself pure for that partner. May our marriages then be completely faithful, totally committed, deeply characterized by love, trust, and companionship. For the glory of God, because we love him. And if we fail, well, when we fail, remember, Jesus broadened this command to include immoral thoughts. When we fail, God is faithful to his covenant promises. And though we may neglect him, he will never reject us. See, remember, as I said last week, we don't keep these commands to get in with God. We keep these commands because we are in God's covenant and we love him for who he is. As we come to an end, let me use the last few verses of Psalm 106 as a prayer for us. So let's bow our heads to pray. Save us, O Lord, our God, and gather us from among the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name and glory in your praise. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. And let all the people say, Amen. Praise the Lord.
Walk and wash away my sin, nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Well, thanks again for joining us this morning. I hope you were encouraged, maybe you were challenged, maybe there's something that God has put on your heart that you need to go away and think and pray about. Well, don't forget to make sure you go and do that. And also don't forget about all the different things that are happening. Check out Church Family News, make sure you're up to date with everything, because there's lots happening, lots that we can get involved with, lots of ways in which we can grow together and encourage one another. But as we finish, let me just read some verses from Psalm 106. Praise the Lord. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. And let all the people say, Amen. Praise the Lord. Lord, our gracious, merciful Father, we praise you and we thank you that you are our God. Please help us to live faithfully for you in the week ahead. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I hope you have a really good week.